Well, good morning. It's a great joy to be with you again. As we come to look in the Word of God, there's a principle of Bible study that's absolutely indispensable, and that's total reliance upon God's Holy Spirit. That principle, the person of the Holy Spirit, that's not a luxury. That's a necessity. How we need the Holy Spirit. Only God can reveal God. He has inspired His Word, and He longs to give light, illumine His Word. Someone made a suggestion some time ago, and they had a little problem with the indispensable principle. And the problem they had was not that they claimed we did it, but the possibility in somebody's mind of thinking, because we have been waiting on the Lord, He has spoken unto us, that our word that we share is infallible. You know we don't mean that. That's the helpless part of the indispensable principle. I've often prayed, and I'll pray again, that the Lord would protect those who listen from anything I say that is not from the Lord. What we have in mind when we say trusting the Holy Spirit is that He would deliver us completely from human wisdom and give us a humble and a receptive heart that will be in harmony with His heart. That's what we're praying. And I know we see through a glass darkly, I pray that we have His message, but I don't want anybody to think, because we think we have light, that we have the right interpretation. You have to weigh these things before the Lord, and as we have had to weigh them before the Lord. I want to share this verse before we go to prayer. It's not on the sheet. By the way, let me just explain those sheets. Well, first of all, you have to notice the superb stapling job. My three grandsons staple those, and you'll never find a finer stapling job than that. The sheets are designed to help you. If they get in the way, just set them aside. But these are the verses in the order in which we're going to quote them. And if that's helpful, then great. Otherwise, just set it aside. The verse I want to share is from Mark 8. This is not on the sheet. Mark 8, chapter 2 and 3, or verses 2 and 3. Our Lord Jesus was feeding the multitude, and we have these words. Jesus said, "I feel compassion for the multitude. They have nothing to eat. If I send them away hungry to their homes, they will faint on the way. Some of them have come from a great distance." Now, I'm going to read it again, and I want you to think spiritually, because we've come to be fed. "I feel compassion," Jesus said, "for the multitude, for they have nothing to eat. If I send them away hungry, they might faint on the way. Some of them have come from a great distance." We don't know each other's heart and where we've been and what God has brought us through to bring us to this place. And some have come a great distance. And the Lord wants to feed us. He has compassion on us. He doesn't want us to faint on the way. And so he wants to meet us, and he wants to feed us. As Mary said in her great prayer, he has fed the hungry with good things, and he sent the rich empty away. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you that we can come again to this place, and we can expect you to have compassion on us and feed us. Refresh your inheritance if it's parched. Strengthen us so we don't faint on the way. Lord, you know who we are and where we are and what our hungers are, our capacities. Meet us where we are. Take us where you'd have us. And we thank you that we can trust you for that. And we commit this session and this weekend unto you in the matchless name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. I want to thank you before we start, well, for the invitation. It's always humbling to be able to address the people of the Lord, and I do thank the Lord for that. But I also thank you for praying for me. Some of you know that in recent days, if it were a couple of days ago, I had almost no voice at all. And God's people prayed, and I praise the Lord for the measure of giving me my voice back. We're just a voice in the wilderness, but then he blasts the voice. I guess weakness is his instrument for good. So I don't want it to be a distraction, but I know also that you didn't come to hear my voice. You came to hear the voice of the Lord. And so that's what we're going to pray. I begin by extending from the responsible brothers of Family Ministries a very warm welcome. We're glad that you're here. In fact, all the saints at Family Ministries join in that welcome. I know Tom and Darlene and my Lillian and myself, we are so glad that you're here. There's some veterans here, been here a while, some new folks, praise the Lord, young people. I love when God brings the young people in. And so I guess we are represented what the Apostle John said, fathers, young men, little children, we're all here. And we're here to meet the Lord. The Lord has met us at Joshua in the past. It's only a place. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1, Paul greets those who in every place call upon the name of the Lord. So it's any place. And we're not against tradition. Someone said tradition is a watch that tells you what time it was. Well, we want visitation, and that's going to tell us what time it is. This is from Isaiah chapter 43. It's also not on your sheet. I don't think it is. Do not call to mind the former things or ponder things of the past. Behold, I will do something new. And so we're trusting God. Praise God for the tradition. Dana Congdon once said that assurance, confidence, is faith with a history. And so we thank God for the history. But now let's ask the Lord to do a new thing. All right, having said all of that and thanking the Lord for this privilege, I want to come right away to the text that the Lord has laid on the heart of my brother Tom and myself. It's from John chapter 17. John chapter 17, you know, is a very precious chapter, sometimes called the Lord's Prayer or the High Priestly Prayer of our Lord Jesus. It's sort of the foundation for the whole book of Hebrews. It tells us how he's praying now in heaven for us. I want to call your attention to John 17, verse 20. I do not ask on behalf of these alone, but for those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. The glory which you've given me, I've given to them, that they may be one just as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me, even have loved me, even as you have loved me. Love them even as you have loved me. Verse 22 and 23 is our focus. The glory which you've given me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. Especially that verse 22, the glory that the Father gave to the Son. Jesus said, I'm giving that glory to you. And if that's the case, if we have the glory that the Father gave Jesus and Jesus gives us, we ought to have a glorious life. And that's why we've titled this little series, The Glorious Christian Life. And so the question that we'll be pressing all weekend, is my life glorious? Whatever that means, we'll touch on what it means. And when others see me, do they see my life as glorious? Whatever that means. So the first thing that I'd like to do, and this is an introduction, and so in an introduction, it's sort of a skeleton and we'll be all over the place. But the first thing I want to do is try to identify that glory. If we are going to receive the glory that the Father gave to the Lord Jesus, we ought to be crystal clear on what that glory is. Clearly, it's not his essential glory. John 17:5, our Lord Jesus prayed, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory I had with you before the world was. Jesus had a glory with the Father before the world was. And that glory belonged to him as God. It's the glory of the Godhead. In our Lord Jesus, that glory was intrinsic. It was in him. The Father did not give the Son the glory of the Godhead. He had that, always had that. But clearly there's a glory that was given to him. John 17:21, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me, I in you, that they may be in us, so the world may know, may believe that you sent me. He speaks about his union, a unique union with his Father. Again, verse 23, I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them as you loved me. The glory the Father gave to the Son is the glory that God gave him to live on earth as a man, as God intended men to live. And Jesus received that glory, and that enabled him to live in this sinful world as God intended man to live. That glory has to do with how to live in this world a glorious life. John 1:14, we read about it. The Word became flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. Glory as of the only begotten from the Father. We can't read that la la la. It's an amazing thing. While Jesus walked on earth, the only explanation for His life was that God had given Him something called glory. And He lived by that glory. He identifies that glory, and it's the same glory that He's promised to give to His children. I want to state it again, verse 21, that they may be one, even as You, Father, are in Me, and I in You. Again in verse 23, I in them, You in Me, that they may be perfected in unity. The glory was His union with the Father who lived inside of Him. Now you say, well, they had unity in eternity. They've always been one. But when He was on the earth, it was different. It was unity, but a different kind of unity. Because the Father was living inside the Son. And Jesus was to depend on the indwelling God. Let me nail it down in words I hope are too clear to misunderstand. When the Father gave His Son glory, He gave Himself. That was the glory. Himself. The Father is the glory. And when Jesus depended on the indwelling Father, that was the only explanation for His life on the earth. Now, do we have an explanation of what that looked like? And the answer is yes. You go through the gospel record, and what I'd like to share with you now is the testimony of Jesus out of His mouth. These are things He said, and He described what life looked like when He depended on His Father. And so we're going to quote only a few of the many passages we could quote. Jesus mentions five things, probably more, but we're going to focus on five. Jesus said, I want you to look at my life because I'm living in union with my Father. And here's what it looks like. John 8, 28 and 29. Jesus said, when you lift up the Son of Man, you will know that I am He, and I do nothing on my own initiative. I speak the things my Father taught me. He who sent me is with me. He's not left me alone. I always do the things pleasing to Him. When you live by the glory, you don't initiate. He said, I don't initiate anything. Everything you see in the life of Christ was initiated by God the Father. And then He says, not only that, John 6:38, I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of Him who sent me. Not only do I not initiate, I don't have a private will. And we know from His prayer in Gethsemane that He was submitted to His Father's will. Matthew 26:39, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass. Not my will, but thine be done. So Jesus said, you want to know how I lived on earth? I didn't initiate anything. You want to know how I lived on earth? I never had a private will. I always did the will of my Father. My meat was to do his will. I lived to do his will. And then he says, if you want to see what it looks like, look again. John 10:37. If I do not the works of my Father, do not believe me. If I do them, though you don't believe me, believe the works, that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. John 14:10, the Father abiding in me, he does the works. That's amazing, because when we usually think about the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we think about the life of Jesus. And we say, my, he did many miracles. He never did a miracle. The Father did the miracles. All the works. He said, you want to know what it looks like when the glory of God is on me? I initiate nothing. You want to know what it looks like? I don't have a will that is not in complete harmony with his. You want to know what it's like? The only way to explain my miracle life is the Father. Everything you've ever seen, the Father did that. Then he says, I want you to look again. John 8:50. I do not seek my glory. John 7:18. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory. You want to know what it looks like when Jesus lived in the glory of the Father? He never initiated anything. He never tried to do his own will. Every single thing that was ever done in his life was done by the Father. He never sought his own glory or his own honor. And then he says one more thing, if you're really going to understand it. John 14:24. The words which you hear are not mine, but the Father who sent me. You know, we study the discourses of our Lord Jesus. Jesus talking to Nicodemus, and Jesus talking to the woman at the well, and Jesus preaching the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus preaching the Sermon in the Plain, and Jesus giving the Bread of Life discourse. He said, not a syllable of that was mine. Everything I ever said, everything you ever heard, everything I ever taught, I got from the Father. John 12:49. I did not speak on my own initiative. The Father himself who sent me has given me a commandment what to say and what to speak. That's how Jesus described his life of glory. Let me just sort of spin it into principles, and let me ask you this question. Would your life be glorious if you never again had to make a decision? Everything's initiated by him. Would that make your life glorious? Would your life be glorious if every moment of your life from this one till the time you went to heaven was lived in the center of the circle of the perfect will of God, and you never took a step outside the will of God? Would that make your life glorious? Would it make your life glorious if God were to deliver you completely from the sin of pride and vainglory, and everything would be done for him? Would it make your life glorious if every step you took from now till the time you got to heaven was a supernatural step, was a miracle? And the one who was indwelling you, he initiated everything. It was his will. It was his honor. It was his glory. It was his works. And everything was by revelation. Would that make your life glorious? If moment by moment everything were revealed to you, every step you had to take And your only responsibility was to enjoy the one who was living inside of you. That's how Jesus lived. That's how he lived his life. He lived his life in an unbroken union with his Father. And he depended 100% on his Father. He set aside who he was by nature and never reached after it to grasp it again. He set aside who he was. And he said, from now on, for my whole life, he will initiate everything. It will only be his will. It will only be his glory. Every work will be from him. All my fruitfulness and all of my productive life will be from him. And day by day, I'll get more and more. I'll be conformed to the image of the one who lives inside of me. See, that's how Jesus lived. That's why he could say, John 12:44. Here's a strange verse for you. Jesus cried out and said, he who believes in me does not believe in me. Did you ever hear a verse like that? He who believes in me does not believe in me, but in him who sent me. He who sees me sees the one who sent me. You remember his conversation with Philip, John 14:7. If you had known me, you would have known my Father. From now on, you know him and have seen him. And Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father. It's enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been so long with you, and yet you've not come to know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own initiative. The Father abiding in me, he does the works. Believe me, I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Otherwise, believe because of the works themselves. Do you see how it begins? This is the glory that God gave Jesus. And this is the glory, he said, now I want to give that to you. Jesus didn't even come to earth on his own initiative. Listen to John 8:42. I proceeded forth. I've come from God. I've not even come on mine own initiative, but he sent me. In every way, it was the Father, the Father. Now, what I'd like to do and have you follow along, please. The Father sent the Son. Out of eternity, he came. And he sent the Son to earth. Why? Why? It was a long journey he took. I want you to follow that journey with me. And I don't want you to get stuck along the way. May God give us help here. Our Lord Jesus, I'm healing. That's where he was ministering. But he didn't stay there, did he? In Galilee. 3.5 years. Say, well, it must have been the transfiguration. That's the glory. That's when he shone forth. Part of the journey. An important part of the journey. But you say his destiny was, Luke 19:10, he came to seek and save the lost. And so his goal must have been Gethsemane and Calvary and the grave. I want you to help me follow this thing reverently. I don't want to just say Gethsemane, Calvary, the cross, the grave, that's just part of the journey. I don't want to be irreverent. There's never a more sacred spot on the journey. He had to go to Gethsemane. There he began to become sin for you, for me. He had to go to the cross. There he poured out his life blood as a substitute for sinful people, for you and for me. He took what we deserved. You know the gospel message. He suffered under the unmitigated wrath of God. I just can't pass by the cross. He crushed eternity into 3 hours. He had to be man to take on the problem, had to be God to solve the problem. For a finite man to sin against an infinite God deserves infinite wages. It would take us all eternity. We couldn't pay because we're finite. And so the God-man took our sins in his own body on the tree. I don't want to just pass over that. And he was accepted. The grave is empty. He was raised from the dead. If even one of your sins was not forgiven, he'd still be dead, because the wages of sin is death. He'd still be dead. The fact that he came out of the grave, so essential, this part of his journey. In the picture, the fire consumed the lamb. In the reality, the lamb consumed the fire. He took our place. And I say I don't want to play with that, but that's still part of the journey. He was only in Gethsemane a couple of hours. That wasn't his destiny. He was only on the cross for 6 hours, and he kept going. He was only in the borrowed grave for 3 days. What was his destiny? That's his journey. That's his journey. He left heaven on that journey. He had to make those stops. So essential. The garden, the cross, the grave. Big part of the journey. But when you make a journey, you're heading someplace. You have a destiny. You have a goal. Where is he going? When will he get there? Even after the resurrection, he didn't stop going. Matthew 26:32. After I've been raised, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. It's not over. After I rise from the dead, now let's go to Galilee. Was that his destiny? Remember what the angel said to the women, Matthew 28:7. Go quickly, tell his disciples he's risen from the dead. He's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you'll see him. Behold, I've told you. And so he goes to Galilee. Matthew 28:16. The 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain what Jesus had designated. When they saw him, they worshiped. But some were doubtful. I don't think it was any part of the 11 that were doubtful. That was settled in the upper room. But Paul tells us 500 people gathered in Galilee. And there, Matthew 28, he gives his great commission. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Say, that must have been his destiny, finally, to get there and give the great commission. No, he's still on the move. Acts 1, verse 4. Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, which he said, you've heard from me. John baptized with water, you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. And so he's on the move. He comes out of heaven, he goes to Bethlehem, and he goes to Nazareth, and he goes to Transfiguration, and into the... He's moving. go to Galilee. They go to Galilee. He says, now you go to Jerusalem and you wait. You wait. And even then, he's not done. He starts moving again in Acts 1:9. After he said these things, he was lifted up while they were looking on, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And so you say, finally, we have the completed circle. He came from heaven. He came and did his marvelous, finished, redemptive work. And he went back to heaven to sit at the right hand of God the Father as one who is victorious. King of glory. King of glory. Not really, because John 14:16, I'll ask the Father, he'll give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not see him or know him. You shall know him, because he abides with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. Listen to this. I will come to you. And so he comes from heaven, he comes down, he does his work, he goes back to heaven, and he says, hang out in Jerusalem. I'm going to come in the person of the Holy Spirit. I'm coming back to you. 10 days pass. My words won't express what happened. Here's inspired words, Acts 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of distributing themselves as of fire, and they rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. Acts 2:12-13. They all continued in amazement, great perplexity, saying to one another, what does this mean? Others were mocking, saying, they're full of sweet wine. And Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, he gave God's explanation. This is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. It shall be in the last days, God said, I'll pour forth my spirit on all mankind. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Young men shall see visions. Old men shall dream dreams. Even on my bond slaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth my spirit, and they shall prophesy. Let me ask you, is that the end? Is that the journey? Is that the goal? Has he reached his destination? Because at Pentecost, the glory that the Father gave the Son, at Pentecost, that is when the Son gave the glory to the church. Is that his final destiny? Now he's come to live in you. Now he's come to live in me. Now it's true, brothers and sisters in Christ. He came all the way from heaven, and he made a stop at the door of your heart. When we were singing earlier, he touched me. My mind went back. Almost 61 years ago, the first touch. He's been touching me ever since, but is that it? He's now arrived at the door of your heart. You've let him in. Has he reached his goal? He was determined to come to you. Nothing in heaven, earth, or hell could have stopped him from coming to you. It's as if our Lord Jesus said this, my Father gave me a mission a long time ago, and I went on a journey. a long journey. A journey through time and space, and I ended up on the earth, and I prepared, I provided a great redemption. He prepared a body for me called an incarnate body. And in that body, I came as far as I could come on my journey. I can't come any further than that, but I haven't reached my goal. John 10:16, I have other sheep who are not of this fold. I must bring them also. They will hear my voice. They'll become one flock, one shepherd. John 17:20, I do not pray on behalf of these alone, but those who will believe in me through their word. Isaiah 53:11, he said, the travail of my soul, I want to see my seed and be satisfied. John 6:37, all the Father gives me will come to me. And him that comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. And it's as if our Lord Jesus is saying this to his church, to us here in Joshua. I came as far as I could come in my incarnate body. I came as far as I could come to take me to my destination. But I haven't arrived. And so what I would like to do is take the glory that God gave me, give it to you, and continue my journey until I reach my destination. He came to live in you because he wants to live in them. That's why he lives in you. That's why he lives in me. He said, I love the unsaved person. I came as far as I could come in my incarnate body. I need a new body now. I need a new body. And I want your permission to live in you. And if I live in you, it'll be sort of the same way than when I lived in my Father. You won't have to initiate anything. I'll take care of that. And you won't have to worry about your will. I'll take care of that. And you don't have to worry about vainglory. I'll take care of that. And you don't have to worry about fruit. I'll take care of that. You don't have to worry about the message. I'll even take care of that. I'll reveal to you. All you have to do is what I did. I lived in union with my Father in an intimate relationship, and I enjoyed him every step. And all you'll have to do is enjoy me every step, and I'll do all the rest. In my incarnate body, Jesus said, I provided redemption. Now, to finish my journey, I must proclaim it. I've got to proclaim my redemption. John 17:22, the glory which you've given me, I've given to them, that they may be one as we are one. John 20:21, Jesus said to them again, peace be with you, as the Father sent me, so send I you. John 6:57, as the living Father sent me, as I live because of the Father, he who eats me will live because of me. John 14:12, truly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. Greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father. And so Jesus says, do I have your permission? I came as far as I could in my incarnate body. But now I've sent the Holy Spirit. I've come to live in your body. And now I need to proclaim it to the ends of the earth. Can I use you? Will you give me your body? Stop initiating. Stop having your private will. Stop seeking your own glory. Stop trying to do it yourself. Let me do it. Stop speaking out of your own mind. Let me give you the message. Will you do that? I need to get it out. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's not about us having a glorious life. It's about our Lord Jesus, who received the commission, and he wants to carry it out, and he wants to do it in his body, the church, you and me. But in order for him to do that, the body has to be glorious, and in order to be glorious, it has to be like his was. He says, greater things than these will you do. I don't want to leave that. I want to say a word about what does he mean, greater things. In what way is it greater? Now, I read through the book of Acts, and there's more than 20 miracles, but they don't seem to be greater than the miracles in the gospel. There's the healing, and there's the raising of the dead, and casting out demons. Seems like the same. It's not greater. In what way, now that he's given you the glory the Father gave him, in what way will the works be greater? Let me suggest two possible ways, and maybe you have others. The first is this. The miracles that Jesus will do now. See, it's the same Jesus. The one who lived in his incarnate body, same Jesus comes to live in you. He lived redemptively, and he's living redemptively again in you. Sometimes Christians quote Hebrews 13, verse 8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, forever. And they make a conclusion that it's not necessarily biblical. You see, when our Lord Jesus did miracles on the earth by his Father, they were signs. They were all signs. They were all pictures. It wasn't the reality. It was pictures. And so he gave sight to the blind to illustrate. He can give sight to spiritually blind. And he gave hearing to the deaf because he can give spiritual hearing. And he can loose tongues so they can praise God. And he can heal feet so they can walk before God and men. And he can cleanse lepers because he can cleanse sin. And he can raise the dead because he can give us a resurrection life. And he can throw Satan out because he has victory over the enemy. Those are all pictures. He did not come into your life to reproduce the picture. He came in your life to reproduce the reality. He comes in to do the reality. He's still doing miracles, but spiritually blind. Some people say, he's the same yesterday. He healed then, he'll heal now. He did this then, he'll do that now. He's come to do the reality, not the picture. Would you rather, if you were hungry, you want a picture of a steak or do you want a steak? If you're cold, would you like a picture of a fire or would you like a fire? If you're lonely, would you like a picture of a friend or would you like a friend? If you're married, is it enough to have a picture of your spouse or do you want your spouse with you and next to you? And so that way it's greater because now he's doing the reality. Here's the second way it's greater. Because in his new body, He has multiplied his presence. When he was in his incarnate body, if he was in Bethlehem, he wasn't in Jerusalem. If he was in Jerusalem, he wasn't in Bethany. If he was in Bethany, he wasn't in Jericho. If he was in Jericho, he wasn't in Nazareth. But now, he's got a new body. Acts 1:8. You'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You'll be witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. And now Jesus, he's everywhere. In Noah and Naomi, Jesus went to China. In Amy and Jim, he went to Brazil. In Ryan and Krista, I can't pronounce it, but he went to Azerbaijan or wherever it is. Maddie Krieg is in Mongolia. He's wherever you live. He's wherever I live. Wherever Christians are, that's where Jesus is. And so the works he does are greater. I want to do two things as we get ready to close. I hope that you're seeing the big picture. Our Lord Jesus is on a journey. It's not over. It's not over. He's still on the journey. And now he's bringing us into it. He's put the glory upon us. I want to share, there's two parts to the message Tom and I are going to develop as God gives us mercy and grace. One part, we're going to call it the revelation of Christ. It's those five things I don't initiate, I don't have my own. It's just relationship with Jesus. It's the revelation of Christ. The second part is the manifestation of Christ. Christ in me, Christ through me. I want to use the vine and the branches, and as I got two more illustrations, this one and then we're done. One more after this. Verse 1 of 15. I'm the true vine. My Father's the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, that it may bear more fruit. You're already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. Apart from me, ye can do nothing. And then verse 16, you did not choose me. I chose you and appointed you that you would go and bear fruit, that your fruit would remain. I don't want to give a full expounding on this wonderful passage, but I want to, just in terms of our series, I want to stand way back and just look at the two parts in this parable. One is the revelation part. In other words, the life flow from the vine into the branch. That's a secret of the branch. It's receiving from the vine the strength, the vigor, the beauty, the fertility of the whole vine, the leaves, the tendrils, the buds, the blossoms, the wood, the fruit, everything is because the branch is drinking, drawing, sucking, taking it in, drinking it up, absorbing it. Everything depends on the vine flowing into the branch. And the branch just clinging and holding and drawing and drinking and taking it all in. That was the glory that Jesus had when he lived on earth. He just lived in total dependence on the one who was living inside of him. Nothing else mattered. In the first 11 verses of John 15, we have the word abide 10 times. You get the idea. That's the first part, abiding in the vine. And you say, how do I know I'm abiding? You're not initiating. You have no private will. You're not seeking your own glory. All your works are from the Lord, and the message is from the Lord. That's how you know you're abiding. But there's another part, John 15:2. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, that it may bring forth more fruit. And then in verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. And then in verse 16, you did not choose me. I chose you, appointed you, that you would go and bear fruit and that your fruit would abide. What is fruit? More fruit. Much fruit. Abiding fruit. And the answer is, it's the byproduct of the vine feeding the branch drawing from the vine. God is not glorified until there's fruit. There's no fruit until you're a glorious Christian. When you're a glorious Christian, the fruit is automatic. He said it in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. Let your light so shine. Your light is Christ. Let your light so shine that they may see your good works and glorify your Father. That's what Paul said in Galatians 1. He says, it pleased God to reveal himself to me. In the last verse in that chapter, and they glorified God in me. The point that I want us to see, and that we need very much to apply, your part is abiding in the vine. The vine has no concern about the fruit. The manifestation of Christ is automatic. That's going to happen. It's not your concern. It's not my concern. It's not your business. It's not my business. Fruit comes as you abide in the vine. Some Christians are so fruit conscious. They're getting this program, that program, everything to bear fruit. And they're not enjoying Jesus. They're not laying hold. As we enjoy the Lord, the fruit is automatic. Without revelation, there's no manifestation. Manifestation. Our Lord Jesus is not reaching his destiny. It's about him. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I'm not trying to be proud. And may God give you ears to hear this as I'm intending it. If you see me, you see Christ. That's what the Christian life is. It's putting on display the one who's indwelling you. And to that degree that you are entering in the same way he entered in, to that degree, Jesus can continue his journey. He's got a bride. I know there's some discussion about hasting the coming of the Lord by getting the bride ready. But getting the bride ready is making the bride complete. And making the bride complete, he's on his journey until the last Christian who will ever say yes, says yes. And when that bride is complete, he's coming back. There's no contradiction, but that's when he's coming back. Last picture, we'll close with it, I promise. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 1 to 3. I want to give a description, a Holy Spirit-inspired description of a person who has never existed. Never existed. You'll see why in a moment. Verse 1. If I speak with the tongues of men and angels and do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, do not have love, I'm nothing. If I give all my possessions to feed the poor, if I surrender my body to be burned, have not love, it profits me nothing. And Paul, with his Holy Spirit-inspired imagination, painted this picture in these three verses of someone that you have never met and you will never meet. But if you did, this is what he would look like. He has matchless eloquence. He speaks with the tongues of men and angels. Ever met anybody like that? That's an amazing person. Not only that, but he has profound insight because he has the gift of prophecies and knows all mysteries. That's pretty wide knowledge. Not only that, but it says he knows everything. So he has an amazing knowledge. Eloquence of an angel, knows all mysteries, knows everything. And then it says he has faith, all faith, to remove mountains. Do you ever meet anybody like that? With the tongue of men and angels, and he knows everything, and he knows all mysteries, and he has all these gifts. Matchless eloquence, profound insight, amazing knowledge, tremendous faith. And it's not over. Look at the surrender. He gives all his possessions, not 90%, all his possessions to feed the poor. And then to add to that, he gives his body to be burned. Is there a more complete surrender than that? That's why that person never existed. Eloquent, knows all mysteries, has all knowledge, has all faith. He's given everything away and he has surrendered his body to be burned. Why did I bring that up? Because Paul says he is like a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. He's nothing. It profits nothing. It's the same thing Jesus said in the parable, without me, you can do nothing. Well, the fact is, you can do a lot without him. Nothing called fruit, but you could do a lot. And people are busy, busy, busy. They're wearing themselves out. They're burning themselves out. Doing nothing. Doing nothing. Without him, you can do nothing. The point I'm making is this. It's not the nature of what you do. This guy did a lot. He gave everything away. He gave his body to be burned. It's the origin of what you do. It's all about the source. And he had not love. And love is the fruit of the Spirit. And he didn't have it from the Spirit. Anything you have ever done since you've been a Christian that has not come because of the Christ that lives in you is worthless. Nothing. Profits zero. Nothing. We're looking at this glorious Christian life where everything comes from him. I don't initiate. I don't have my own will. I don't seek my own glory. I don't do my own works. Nothing in the message I have, he keeps revealing, and I get conformed day by day to him. That's what it's about. That's the glorious life. And Jesus said, if I have a life like that, I can continue my journey. I long for the lost. I long for the unsaved. I love them. I want them to come to me. I got to live in my body. And the only way they can live on earth is the way I lived on earth. And that is the glory the Father gave me. I'm going to give to them. And the same union I had with Him, you can now have with me. There's no other Christian life. Anything less than that is not the Christian life. That is the Christian life. As He was, so are we in this world. And He's called us to live in that union. The way Tom and I are looking at this, Jesus lived in His incarnate body. And we are going to look at what did that look like. Now we have chosen post-Pentecost illustrations. All of the illustrations we're going to use are after Pentecost. They're in the book of Acts. And the reason is because this is how Jesus looked when He lived in His incarnate body. Now, how does it look when He lives in His mystical body, the church? How does it look like when Jesus lives in Philip, and when He lives in Stephen, and when He lives in Peter, and when He lives in Silas? We're going to follow post-Pentecost illustrations of how Jesus lives now in us. All of that, let's pray. Father, thank You so much for Your word. Not what we think it might mean, but You have inspired it to mean what You mean. And we would ask You to write what You mean on our hearts. Lord, we pray that You might take us forward in the truth of what it means to have the glory of God upon us. To have the life, the same life our Lord Jesus lived. Now You living in us, in the person of the Holy Spirit. Oh Lord, take us forward in this truth. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.